Hello, and welcome to the Evelyn Y. Davis Studios at the National Press Foundation. Today we're talking about the surge in hate crimes and best practices for journalists to report on acts of hate and extremist groups.
The National Press Foundation is a nonprofit dedicated to helping journalists cover complex topics with depth and accuracy. We serve journalists in the U.S. and around the world.
I'm Sandy Johnson, president of the National Press Foundation. The Southern Poverty Law Center has documented more than 1,000 acts of hate since the November 8th election. The surge of hate acts against people of color, religious minorities, and the LGBTQ community poses many challenges for journalists. With me in the studio today is Jesse Holland, who reports on race and ethnicity for the Associated Press. And joining us by Skype is Heidi Beirich, Intelligence Project Director at the Southern Poverty Law Center. She oversees SPLC's authoritative annual count of hate crimes and extremist groups. So thank you both for joining us today.
Thank you.
So thank Heidi, you. Let's start with you. Where does that hate crime count stand since the November 8th election?
We are well over 1,000 hate crimes. We had about 800 of them in the first 4 weeks, and then things slowed down a little bit, and they've been, you know, trickling in basically over the last, I'd say, 2 weeks. We're probably around 1,300 hate crimes at this point since the election.
And can you break it down by who has been targeted since the election?
Yeah, the major categories of targeting have been folks perceived as immigrants and Muslims. That said, there are huge other categories, like you just mentioned, the LGBT category, where there have been, you know, more than 100 hate incidents and hate crimes, and frankly, almost every single population has been attacked in some way: Jews, African Americans. This basically ran the gamut of all of the hate crime categorizations that we have in the FBI's data. So there really wasn't any group of, you know, minority population that was spared from the outbreak of hate that happened after the election.
And has there been any sort of pattern among the types of crimes or hate acts?
Well, they've happened all across the United States. No part of the country has been spared. If I were to point to something unique in there, it's probably the fact that about 40% of these incidents have happened on colleges and school campuses, like K-12 campuses. And that's a high number when you go back and look at the FBI's hate crime statistics in general. That's not a place where you find 4 out of 10 of these incidents usually happening. So that's been the most unique thing.
Mm-hmm. And Heidi, how does the trend line since the elections of 2016 compare with the Obama transition 8 years ago?
Well, we definitely had, we had an outbreak of hate crimes around the time of Obama's election. The pattern was slightly different because in that case, the perpetrators in general were people angry about Obama's election. In other words, they had voted for the other candidate. Here we have the opposite happening. Getting over a cold. So people are emboldened in this case, and they didn't last as long with Obama. They lasted a much shorter period of time.
The elections of 2016 compared to the Obama transition 8 years ago.
So for both of you, did the rhetoric of the campaign play a role in the uptick of hate incidents, Jesse?
Well, it's hard not to make that correlation that where you the rhetoric that we saw, the divisive rhetoric we saw during the campaign, it's hard not to see that as being one of the reasons why we saw this surge in hate crimes. This was one of the more divisive campaigns that we've seen in definitely in my two decades here in Washington. It's probably one of the more divisive campaigns we've seen in a while. So it's hard not to see that as being one of the reasons why we saw that surge. We had, I mean, keep in mind that it started, President-elect Trump's campaign started with what some people consider slur against Mexicans. Mm-hmm. And we saw all of these incidents happening at campaign rallies. So it's hard to see, to not say, to see that and not say this was one of the reasons. But we also have to keep in mind it was a very divisive year, even outside of the presidential campaigns, with the publication of the shootings of African Americans by police and some the shootings of police around the nation. So I wouldn't say it was just the political campaigns, but it was definitely, I think it's easy to say it was definitely part of it.
Mm-hmm. And Heidi, what did you see?
I completely agree with that analysis. The rhetoric in the campaign is almost directly correlated to the populations that were attacked. So the rhetoric about Mexicans the day Trump announced, the rhetoric about Muslims and banning them from the country after the November terrorist attacks in San Bernardino, these created the climate that then expressed itself in hate crimes. And that's not unique just to this campaign. We know in past eras when Latinos were the target of rhetoric from public officials that was negative, we saw outbreaks of hate crimes in that population. It's a pattern we see over and over again. And it's also one that we saw in England after the Brexit vote, where immigrants were heavily targeted. They tend to be Muslim in that country. And we saw a huge outbreak of hate crimes and hate incidents in England in the wake of that election. That's another parallel that we have to what's been happening here.
Mm-hmm. Let's step back for a minute and look at some historical numbers of hate crimes. Heidi, can you talk about the hate crimes that have been reported by the SPLC versus the FBI numbers?
Yeah, well, there are a couple huge disparities here in the way we track hate crimes in the United States. So SPLC collects information on bias incidents. Those are things that might not rise to the level of an actual crime, and then hate crimes as well. And those numbers that we collect, which are largely from news reports and lately have been from self-reporting and other sources, tend to be, along the lines of what the FBI reports every year, which is about 5,000 to 6,000 hate crimes. But the Department of Justice has issued three huge reports over the last 6 or 7 years that were analyses of survey data from something called the National Crime Victimization Survey that happens every year. And that data shows that the United States has about 250,000 hate crimes a year. They're just undocumented. And the disparity between that number, right, the 250,000 and the 5,000 or 6,000 the FBI reports, shows us how horribly underreported this kind of violence is. And really, if people understood that underreporting better, they would understand that we have a more serious problem with hate violence, and this isn't just, in the wake of the election, but in general in this country than any of us tend to be aware of.
I think that's one of the ways that journalists can step in. I mean, that's right. a huge disparity, and that's one of the things that we'll explore in this webinar is when do journalists step in and report these crimes when it comes to their attention.
Right.
And Jesse, where did journalists typically get their information about hate crimes or hate incidents?
Now, one of the things that, especially as a journalist, we have to keep in mind is that as journalists, we can't classify something a hate crime. For us, the classification has to come from someone else. For example, a hate crime for us is normally not declared by a police agency or a law enforcement agency, or a group like the Southern Poverty Law Center. We as reporters cannot look at something and declare that this is a hate crime. At least we shouldn't. That is a job that does not belong to reporters, to look at something and say, declare on our own that something is a hate crime. So we should turn to organizations that specialize in these type of incidents, or law enforcement agencies, when a charge is actually filed. Keep in mind that at least 45 states in the District of Columbia have state-level laws that deal with hate crimes and hate incidents, as well as the federal government having laws covering hate crimes and hate incidents. So on our own, what we can say is that a crime has been committed. But when you start talking about a hate crime, that's actually a classification that is labeled by another organization, not by journalists. Mm-hmm. That's something that we always have to be sure about, because you can declare, if we did that on our own, and then later if it wasn't a hate crime, then we would have put out incorrect information. So that's something that we have to be really careful about, is that on our own, we should not declare things hate crimes. Those are classifications that belong to someone else, that they that we can report that another organization said that this could be a hate crime. Mm-hmm. But we just can't declare that on our own, and we shouldn't.
Mm-hmm. And before we get into a more detailed discussion of what is or isn't, and we're going to have some real examples, Heidi, could you walk us through SPLC's U.S. map of extremist groups?
Sure, sure. So every single year, usually early February, the Southern Poverty Law Center issues a report called the Year in Hate, and included in that is a list of hate groups across the United States. We've been doing this for about 20 years. And it includes, you know, several different kinds of organizations. Some of them are obvious to all of us, the Ku Klux Klan, for example, neo-Nazis. Others may be less apparent. We also list anti-LGBT groups, anti-Muslim groups. And then there are some, you know, frankly, weird factions in the hate movement in the United States, like Christian Identity, which is a perverted read of the Bible that's basically anti-Semitic. So we have all these different groups. And what we have been seeing since 2000 is basically a trend line that just is more and more and more of these organizations. In the year 2000, there were 602 hate groups across the nation. And within pretty short order, we were over 1,000. The last few years, we have been in the high 800s, low 900s in terms of the number of hate groups. So basically what we had was a doubling of the number of these organizations since the millennium. In the prior decade, the numbers did not grow like that. They kind of bounced around 450, 500, and down a little, up a little bit. Mm-hmm. So there's no question that the organizational part of the hate movement in the United States has expanded since 2000, and there's actually a reason for that. That was the year that the census announced that in 2042, white people would become a minority population in the United States. In other words, there would be no majority sort of ethnic population in the United States as of that time. And hate groups were very aware of what that meant for them because they want a white-run nation, and they began organizing, in particular against immigrants because they viewed the Latino population, which was growing, as a major threat. So that's been the basic trend line. We have more people involved in organized hate groups in the United States than we have in, you know, 20-some plus years.
Mm-hmm. Oh, so Heidi, let me just quantify what you said. I'll repeat it. You said in 2000 there were about 600 of these hate groups, and it was 1,000 for a few years, and now it's between 800 and 900 groups. Is that correct?
That's right.
And yeah, and let me explain. Do you have any idea membership numbers?
Yeah. Well, let me just clarify one thing on group. I'm saying groups, but this can be a group, like, for example, the Neo-Nazi National Alliance that has 5 chapters. Mm-hmm. So we would count all of those chapters. So let me just say that to clarify. The second question that you're asking is actually a harder one to answer, because these are organizations that don't want to share their membership lists, right? They don't want anyone to know that they're involved in these groups. They tend to work anonymously. Or if they give a membership number, they might inflate those numbers greatly. So we don't have hard evidence. What we do have is we can point to things like stormfront.org, which is the largest, actually the oldest hate site on the web. They have 300,000 registered users there. If I were to add together the registered users at, say, the top 5 hate sites, we'd be looking at more than 500,000 people. We know there are more than that involved in the groups. Because they're much more widespread than just these forums. So it's hard for us to know, and this is frankly a guesstimate, but in terms of hardcore haters, right, white supremacist believers, it's probably, you know, and these are like card-carrying believers, it's probably around 1 million, maybe 1.5 million.
Mm-hmm. And the name of that website again?
Stormfront.org.
Okay, let's talk about the difference between hate crimes and acts of hate. Heidi, what is the legal definition?
So to legally be a hate crime, the incident has to involve things that are, you know, what you would consider crimes. So, for example, vandalism, I would say, is the lowest level of a hate crime. And then every kind of category of attack that you can think of, assaults, robberies, and all the way up to murder, can be considered hate crimes if there is evidence that the perpetrator attacked the person or did the property damage because they were motivated by some sort of animus against the categories that are listed in hate crimes. So anti-Muslim, anti-black, anti-white, anti-Semitic. It's longer than that. There's a disability category and some others. But the point of this is these are what we consider crimes. We've always considered crimes, but that animus has to be demonstrated in some way. So obviously, if someone attacks you and is screaming about the fact that you're Jewish, or they just think you're Jewish, so it doesn't really matter whether the victim is part of these categories or not, it's about the perpetrator, then you have demonstrated evidence that that was motivated by hate. So it has to be two things: the documentation of the crime, and then the ability to have evidence that the motivation was driven by, you know, some sort of animus, racial, religious, and so forth.
Mm-hmm. And is there a federal standard that guides state law, or do the state laws stand alone?
No, the state laws stand alone, and they're all different. As you guys had just said, so there are states actually that don't have hate crimes laws. South Carolina, where Dylan Roof is on trial for the mass shooting in Charleston of African Americans, does not have a hate crime law. There are other states that way, and each state makes a decision on what they're going to consider worthy of being designated as a hate crime. So, for example, I live here in Montgomery, Alabama. We do not protect the LGBT community. That's true of many other southern states for hate crimes. They're just not included. So there's a lot of unevenness across the United States in terms of what are protected populations and what are not protected populations. And then the federal statute, which protects just about every category that most of us would think about, has very limited application because they don't have jurisdiction usually. The crime would have to occur sort of on federal property, for example. They have to establish jurisdiction that falls outside of the state, or in a place like South Carolina with Dylan Roof, who is charged under the federal hate crime statute, where there is no hate crime law.
And Sandy, let me jump in here. And this is something that's going to be important for journalists to know. They need to know what their particular state hate crime statute is and what it covers. Simply because, for example, last year, Louisiana actually added police and firefighters to their state hate crimes law, mm-hmm. where crimes against someone because they're a police officer or a firefighter would count as a hate crime. There are places like the District of Columbia where homelessness is included as a, it could be included as a state level hate crime. So it's incumbent upon journalists to know what their state hate crime law says, because it could be different across different jurisdictions. You could have one law in Virginia, you could have one law in Maryland, and the law could be completely different in Pennsylvania. Mm-hmm. So it's incumbent upon journalists who cover these issues to know what their particular state law says. And that's something you can easily find from your state attorney general.
Mm-hmm. Is there one-stop shopping across states, like a place, a repository where it shows every state? Or do you really need to go to your own state?
Laws change so frequently mm-hmm. that I would suggest to people to go to their own state legislature and their state law enforcement officials to find out what their state law says. Mm-hmm. Now, there are organizations like I believe it's the National Association of State Legislatures, who track that type of information. But to be safe, I would always go to the source of the law to find out what that law says. And that's usually your state law enforcement officers or your state legislature.
Mm-hmm. And Jesse, you represent an organization that has reporters all across the company. As journalists, does the Associated Press or other national news organizations, do they have their own internal standards on how to report on hate crimes?
Now, and this is one of the things that I want to emphasize. Each media organization has its own standards. So if you're a journalist and you're having to cover these issues, you should have these conversations with your editors and your own internal standards staff before you write about them. But in general, each organization will make up its own standards for reporting on hate crimes. But in general, we all operate under the same standards that we don't declare things hate crimes. We have to have a organization like a state law enforcement organization or a group like the Southern Poverty Law Center. Someone has to tell us that this could be considered a hate crime, because we can't We can't assume what's in someone's mind. That's just a basic tenet of journalism. So I think that goes across the board for journalists. Now, of course, as you know, it's different for commentators. It's a difference for people who write opinion columns. But for those of us on the front lines writing the news stories, we should never assume that something is a hate crime until the hate crime charges have been filed or an organization who's done some type of investigation has said that. Because one of the big examples, especially that's on my mind recently, was a church burning during the election in the South where someone wrote vote Trump on a black church and burned the church. And police in the last couple of months arrested an African-American man for doing this. Now, of course, that doesn't mean it's not a hate crime. But the assumption, because of what was written on the church, was that this was a hate crime based on religious and or racial intolerance. Mm-hmm. But it ended up being a black man who was arrested for burning a black church. Mm-hmm. So we should never jump ahead and make assumptions that something is a hate crime unless charges have been filed. So we just have to be really careful.
One step before that, is it appropriate for a reporter to ask the police, are you investigating this as a hate crime?
It is always appropriate to ask as many questions as possible. And if police say we're investigating this as a hate crime, that is legitimate to be reported. But on your own as a reporter, if you just cannot say that this is a hate crime that's being investigated, because you as a journalist cannot make that distinction in a story yourself. That's inserting your personal opinion into a news story. And that's something that we as journalists shouldn't do. So if it's being investigated as a hate crime, that's not something that we should say. That's something that we should have go to the police, go to an organization that tracks hate crimes and ask. But we can't say that on our own.
Mm-hmm. There's also a distinction between law enforcement investing something as a hate crime and charging someone,
right,
and then making the decision to move forward with prosecution. Heidi, can you tell us how often that happens, or what the challenges are for law enforcement in the instances of hate crimes?
Yeah, well, this is where trying to figure out how many hate crimes we have in the United States every year or not, it gets even murkier than the disparity in the numbers that I was talking about earlier. Because there are many cases where, so let's say police investigated something as a hate crime. Let's even say there may have been evidence of some kind of animus, racial, religious, whatever it might be. But once it gets to the prosecutor, he or she is going to make a decision about the best course of action to take in terms of prosecuting this person, right? And there are many cases where people take the hate, I should add, there's two things here. Oftentimes, hate crimes add to sentences. What actually happens is when you're prosecuted for a hate crime, you have a sentencing enhancement. That's true in some cases, and in other states it's not. That is why it's critically important you know what your state's rules are. But a prosecutor may decide not to enforce that enhancement for some reason that has to do with the evidence that they're facing as they make the call. And so something that may have looked like a hate crime beforehand, or the cops may have even investigated as that, may not be prosecuted as a hate crime. And the fact that there was any evidence at all about racial animus can get lost in this process. So it's, and prosecutors make independent decisions about how to move forward and how to be judicious and efficient and so on. So oftentimes a case that may have looked as though it was definitely going to be a hate crime at the end of the day doesn't get prosecuted that way and doesn't go into the books in that way. So you have to be careful around those issues as well.
Let's talk a little bit more about reporters' roles in describing and reporting on hate crimes. Are racial identifiers or other identifiers of the victim important when writing about hate crimes?
Especially when you're dealing with hate crimes specifically, you need to, especially as journalists, we need to be careful about the wording that we use. For example, there's a case coming out of Illinois today where what has been described as a mentally disturbed man was, I'm trying to make sure I described this correctly, was assaulted by four African Americans who have been arrested by the police. Now, when this story is written, you have to include the racial identifiers because this could be a hate crime, but we don't know that because they haven't been charged with anything yet. But when we write the story, it is incumbent upon us to be clear and specific about any identifier that we use in that story, especially when dealing with a very sensitive topic like hate crimes. There are some situations, for example, we can't call it a hate crime until a charge. Someone else says that they've either been charged under a hate crime, or the police or an organization like the Southern Poverty Law Center says this is a hate crime. So we have to be very careful. And these are conversations that newspapers and journalists need to have beforehand to find out your organization's standards on this. These are all conversations we should have before we write about these stories, because each situation could be different. But especially when dealing with attacks of people of two different races or different race and different ethnicity, those identifiers can be important to describe for people what actually happened. But they're not always the key piece of information that need to be included in the story.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. And what about naming the victims? Most journalism organizations do not identify the victims of sexual crimes, for instance.
Right.
How does that apply in hate crimes? Should we name the victims as well as the perpetrators?
Most journalistic organizations will tell you that they do not identify the victims of sexual abuse. They very rarely identify the victims of domestic abuse. We never identify underage victims of any type of crime. There are conversations going on now about whether victims of hate crimes should be afforded the same consideration that victims of domestic abuse and victims of sexual abuse have. But I will also say there is a conversation going on in the journalistic community about whether we are doing the right thing by not naming victims of sexual abuse and domestic abuse, simply because some journalistic organizations will tell you that by not naming them, that we're treating adults like children, and that perhaps we're adding more stigma to victims of domestic abuse and sexual abuse by not naming them. And would that be the same thing happening if we included victims of hate crimes in that same consideration? I have to keep emphasizing this. These are all conversations that need to be had inside newsrooms before these incidents happen. There needs to be policy set by that organization that reporters follow, so all of these incidents are treated consistently, and that these decisions are not being made at the last second when something happens. Mm-hmm. So,
Heidi, does the Southern Poverty Law Center have internal guidelines on naming victims or identifying people by race, ethnicity, sexual identity?
Well, in this case, we're actually following what the press reports tend to be, because we're collecting information, right, from journalists about this. And when the victim is identified, we identify it as well when we report on the incident. So we have been doing that, sort of following in the wake of how journalists are handling this issue. It's an interesting question, because one of the unique things about hate crimes and really why hate crimes exist is because hate crimes have an impact beyond just the victim. Of course, the victim takes the brunt of it, not to make light of that at all. But when people are targeted because they're Muslim, because they're Jewish, because they're African American, that can spread quite a bit of fear in communities that this violence is not just directed at one person, but could be something that affects the rest of that community. That's what really makes hate crimes scary and can really terrorize communities. So it's an interesting question you raise, but we sort of follow the guidelines that are in place for journalists on that.
And if journalists publish photos or videos of hate crimes, are they encouraging copycats or harassment of the victim?
That's one of the things that we have to be very careful in the media about, because are we ending up spreading the message of the perpetrator of hate crimes by reporting it? Of course, the people always have the right to know. And that it's our job as journalistic organizations to provide information to our readers, our listeners, our viewers. But one of the things we have to be sure as part of our journalistic responsibility is to ensure that we're not just in reporting these incidents, we are not spreading the information that those the perpetrators of the hate crime want out there. It's a careful balancing act, but that's something that we have to keep in mind as journalists. For example, we don't want to report spurious bomb threats, because that would just encourage more people to make them just for the disruption. Do we then put that standard on hate crimes? Because we don't want to encourage more hate crimes by reporting the fact that a hate crime happened. But we also don't want to not report the hate crime, because it's our job as journalists to report things that are going on in our communities. It's a fine line that we have to walk, but it's one that we have to keep in mind, especially as responsible news organizations. We have to balance the idea of getting the information out to our readers, our viewers, our listeners, versus making sure that we're not prompting copycats by glorifying the act that has just occurred that was a crime.
Mm-hmm. Let's go back to that incident that happened or that came to light earlier today in Chicago. Mm-hmm. I understand that there's video of that. And should the media repeat that? I mean, should we be publicizing the video? I assume people are watching this right now.
One of the unique aspects of the crime of the alleged crime that happened this morning is that the perpetrators apparently live streamed some video on Facebook. Each media organization has its own rules about what is appropriate for its audience. I will tell you, even though I've had an opportunity this morning, I have yet to watch this video. But it's going to be up to the news judgment of each organization on whether they should or should not link to this video. It was part of the same conversation we had in the previous year about linking and publicizing videos of African-American men and women who were being shot by police. Mm-hmm. Are these videos appropriate for our audience? But that's a decision that each news organization needs to make on its own, because everyone's audience is different.
Mm-hmm. Now, for the AP, is that a case-by-case decision, or are there some rules that apply generally?
Well, there are general rules of news appropriateness, mm-hmm. but each decision is made on a case-by-case basis, depending on what the ownership of the video, the authenticity of the video, the appropriateness of the video for our audiences. So we always favor providing more information than less. But there are always individual decisions that have to be made on information that we put on our wire, because then once we have to stand behind information that we provide. So we always try to make sure that the information we provide to our audiences is the most accurate and the most appropriate for that situation.
Mm-hmm. Heidi, can we talk about the social media space for a second and cyber crimes? Have you seen an uptick in use of social media in terms of hateful acts or even hate crimes?
Yes, this last year has been very, very ugly in many quarters online. This past summer, there was a very heavily reported on outbreak of attacks by neo-Nazis, and by this I mean online attacks, where they were sending sort of pictures of, you know, Jews, caricatures of Jews being shot, and really anti-Semitic material to journalists who identified as Jewish and, you know, who were reporting on the campaign. They're not hate crimes. This is still in the realm of free speech, even though it can be really, really ugly. And obviously there were a lot of celebrities and journalists and others who simply left places like Twitter because they decided that it was enough, right? They were sick of getting this barrage of, you know, the equivalent of hate mail all day long. And I think this is something the tech companies are really wrestling with, what the line should be, where something becomes harassment, and so on. But I should say, in terms of criminal acts, it is very unlikely that any of that material will ever rise to a criminal case. The protections provided by the First Amendment on free speech are very, very wide. And for something to count as what the law calls a true threat, the threat has to essentially be directed at someone, be clear that they are going to be attacked, and it has to be, under current legal standards, imminent. And that means it's more likely a face-to-face situation, or say a Klansman were having a rally and they pointed to someone in the crowd and said, attack that person. That's the traditional idea of a true threat in one of these cases. And that doesn't really apply to all of this online material. That said, there are a lot of people looking at, well, maybe when this kind of material is flooding at you, that there is a level of harassment. But we don't really have the legal tools yet to deal with that. So most of this content, which is, you know, really, really vile, falls under free speech protections.
As opposed to true threat.
That's right. As opposed to a true threat, or maybe being criminal under some kind of harassment tort that we haven't been able to figure out yet. Online harassment is basically protected speech at this point in time.
Okay, let's look at some specific examples. We've got a slide that shows a car that was vandalized in Colorado, and the owner is a transgender woman. Is or is not that a hate crime? We've got the slide up now.
That's a hate crime for sure. Whether or not you can find the perpetrator or not, it is. And it's actually not, in this case, because of the swastikas, right? It doesn't matter who the owner of the vehicle is. This is anti-Semitic vandalism. That's how it would be prosecuted if you could find the person who did it under a hate crime law in just about every case.
And Jesse?
I'm sorry. I just saw the part that's also anti-gay. I hadn't seen that originally. That would be another category of hate crime.
Well, once again, as a journalist, you would look at that scene and you would ask the police officer, how are they investigating? Are they investigating this as a hate crime? Now, one of the things we have to keep in mind that, of course, as journalists, we're human beings as well. We will have our personal opinions on whether we think that's a hate crime. But as far as our journalistic responsibility goes, you cannot write something as a hate crime unless the police are investigating or as a hate crime, or if an organization that is an expert in this area says this should be investigated as a hate crime. As a journalist, I can't personally declare that is a hate crime. It's obviously vandalism. Mm-hmm. But as a journalist, that is the decision of whether this is something that can be prosecuted as a hate crime is something that would have to come from another organization like the police.
Mm-hmm. Heidi, have you seen an increase in acts of hatred or hate crimes against the LGBTQ community?
Yeah, we have. And in the post-election data, you can see that as well. And I should say about that community, this is an important issue. If you take the hate crimes data going all the way back to when they first started collecting it, which was in 1991, the group of people who are the most attacked violently, so you're dropping out the property defacement and that kind of thing, just the violent crimes, out of proportion to what they are in the population, that's the LGBT community. They have been targeted more for violent hate crimes than any other population. And so that car that you saw, which I missed at first, the anti-gay material, anti-trans material, that's not surprising because, unfortunately, that is a population that is very, very terribly targeted. And also in many states, like I mentioned earlier, in the South, for example, there are no hate crime protections for that population, even though it is targeted in this way.
And that's true across the South?
I'm not sure if it's every single Southern state. I think it's all of the Deep South states. Then, of course, you have cases like South Carolina where there's just no hate crimes law.
Okay, the next example is a high school in Minnesota that was vandalized. Here we go. Is this a hate crime?
Yeah, that's vandalism. that is expressing white supremacist ideas. It's got some racism there. And I have to say the fact that Trump was mentioned in this case is a little similar to many of the incidents we've collected since the election, where the person perpetrating the bias crime or attack has said that they support Trump or use Trump's name in some way. You know, but once again, I think the example in Mississippi from earlier has to be sort of kept in mind for those of you reporting on these issues, because, you know, there could be evidence that shows up later that shows that maybe this was something else like happened in that church case.
And then once again, that this brings up the point of that why we as journalists shouldn't declare unilaterally what is a hate crime and what isn't, because this could be something, this could be a prank by someone attempting to make it look like a hate crime. So this is why we as journalists should look to law enforcement organizations and look to other organizations to say if something's being investigated, not just unilaterally declare that because a racist statement is made in through graffiti that something is a hate crime.
But vandalism itself of this nature is considered a crime.
Is a crime, definitely.
So the distinction is this a hate crime or not?
Right, because right. It, with just that photo, we don't know the intent of the perpetrator. Mm-hmm. The intent of the perpetrator could be racial animus, but it also could be, let's see if we can just stir things up. Mm-hmm. And we don't know who did it. We don't know why. All of that is the purview of the police and the prosecutors. Mm-hmm. And we as journalists should not try to jump ahead of the actual case that they're going to be building, because we don't know. All we know is what's in front of us. We don't know what the police officers and law enforcement know. So we should not, on our own, unilaterally, just from what we see, say this is a hate crime while this is not.
Mm-hmm. Heidi, you said earlier that there has definitely been an increase in hateful acts at schools across the country, including elementary schools. Is there any kind of pattern to the type of vandalism or acts of hate that you've been seeing? Is it similar to what we see on this slide?
It is like that. Some of it has actually been more face-to-face. I would say the characterization, of, especially at the K-12 level, has been mostly anti-immigrant and anti-Muslim, and has unfortunately in many cases been related to the Trump campaign. In other words, the person, for example, maybe screaming at a Muslim student is bringing up Trump, or we've had, you know, sort of kids chanting at immigrant kids, build the wall, those kinds of incidents have been reported all over. But there's also been a lot of this graffiti. And I just want to add one thing, too, of picking up on the idea that you know, what if that were a hoax graffiti? Of the number of cases that we've collected since the election, there have been about a dozen or so that turned out to be hoaxes. So it is good, you know, it's good to keep in mind that may always be a possibility. That's not to undercount the importance of, you know, hate violence in our society or hate thinking, hate groups and all that. But we have had cases of hoaxes and you know, they need to be reported correctly, right? We need the numbers to be accurate, right? The reporting to be accurate. Mm-hmm.
Okay, another example. We've got a hateful voicemail that was left at a Grand Rapids, Michigan church after the elections. And we're going to play this little bit of audio for you.
I think this is the gay church. I hope gays get kicked out of the country along with all the freaking Mexicans that are illegal, that you guys are hiding illegally. Trump gets you. Trump. Trump's gonna kick your asses out of here and throw you over the wall. You dirty, rotten scumbags. Hillary is a cum scumbag bitch. Too bad. Wah. Hillary lost. Trump's gonna get you. Throw you over the wall.
Okay. Heidi, what do you think?
Well, unfortunately, we've heard too much of this kind of language since the election. And this is a bit like I was saying on the school cases where you have the person making the hateful statements, you know, talking about Trump as well. Now I will say this is most likely protected speech. In other words, it's a hate incident, but it's probably protected. We all love the First Amendment, so part of that comes with also
we definitely
allowing
do.
People to say, yeah, saying things, exactly, but it comes with people saying things like this. And unless this person were to keep calling and harassing over a period of time, there's probably not a legal remedy. They have the right to say these things.
Mm-hmm. Jesse, what do you think?
Well, there's no doubt about it being racist and horrific. But once again, it falls under the First Amendment. It falls under free speech, but it definitely could be reported as the racist voicemail being left at left racist and homophobic voicemail being left as a church at a church. But once again, we can't declare as journalists, we shouldn't, and we can't declare something as a hate crime or a hate incident on our own. But it's clear just from listening to it that it's racist and anti-gay.
Mm-hmm. I think what these last two examples raise the question for the organizations that have been targeted, in one case a church, in another case a school. When should they report these acts of hate, whether or not they rise to a level of being a crime that will be invested by police? Heidi, what is your guidance to organizations who receive messages like this?
You should always, always report them and record them. Churches in particular of all kinds in the United States are often targets of this kind of behavior. And you need to keep those records, or if they're emails, for example, whatever it might be, you need to keep those records. You need to send them to law enforcement. One of the things that came out in the Charleston trial of Dylan Roof is that he had actually called Mother Emanuel Church in Charleston. I don't remember how many days it was before the attack, from his mother's home phone. And they did report it to law enforcement, but that church unbelievably gets so many threats that it's almost impossible to sort through it all. If we had been lucky enough and maybe traced that, maybe that attack might not have happened. So that material has got to get in the hands of law enforcement.
And I would actually add to that, it also should be reported to your local media as well. Mm-hmm. Because sometimes sunshine is always the best disinfectant. When you tell the local media or your state-run state media, your state media, you will get action that may or may not have happened if you just reported it to the police. I always tell people that I deal with that your first call should be the police, but your second call should be your local media. Mm-hmm. Because you want not only the police to know, you want people in your community to know that this is happening. So in addition, you maybe someone in the neighborhood will say, well, you know, I saw something that night. So in addition to calling the police, you should also call your local media.
Mm-hmm. And if people report these actions to the police, aren't they noted in police logs as a matter of form?
They are. Well, I would assume that they are, not being a police officer, I would assume that they are all noted and logged in your police incident reports. But you can't always guarantee that those police incident reports are always seen by your local media. I would always contact the media directly.
And Heidi, do you have any thoughts on that?
Oh, I think that's exactly right. I think that's exactly right. And it's a very good point on the media in terms of getting action as a result of that. You know, and I also think it's important for people in a community to know what's going on this front. And that helps put pressure on, sort of political folks to deal with problems where they erupt. And, the law enforcement really wants to know this information. Because unfortunately, when you have a hate group or something show up in your community, you can quickly get hate crimes. And when you let people know that these incidents are happening, it allows law enforcement to be on top of it. But that is a great point about the media.
Okay, let's go to another example. There were six nooses found at different construction sites in the D.C. Washington suburbs. And the Washington Post reporting that I saw on this really circled around the issue. Workers showed up at these construction sites and the nooses were hanging there when they got there. So Heidi, what do you think?
Well, this is a difficult one. I mean, look, the history of the noose in America is one of the, you know, the most vile racial animus, period. But even so, you don't have a lot of information here about what the context is, who's targeted. You know, it's just as a symbol, it screams, you know, horrific racism, but I would be careful about what it might mean, because you don't know, like, is it a hoax? Did somebody, I just, there's not much information with it.
Mm-hmm. Jesse, what do you think?
We would be able to write a noose was found, and then perhaps give context of nooses and their use in the South during the Civil Rights and Jim Crow era. But I don't know how you can just say that is a hate crime just from a noose being found. As a journalist, your job is to report that a noose was found and give the context, but you cannot say that particular incident specifically is a hate crime just because a noose was found there.
Mm-hmm. And the local reporting basically echoes what you just said.
Exactly.
They circled around the issues,
exactly.
A noose was found, the workers were horrified and reported it. Right, and law enforcement was looking into it.
Law enforcement was investigating.
Right,
correct.
Right. Do either of you have other acts of hate or incidents that you think are right on the bubble, or that are they're clearly hate crimes that you think would be useful examples for journalists to know?
Well, that noose one is actually really good. I think sometimes you have things that are like ambiguous graffiti that are hard to understand. And another thing I think happens oftentimes is what is really a hate incident. Like, for example, the Klan comes through a neighborhood and throws flyers in people's yards, which is them exercising their First Amendment right, can sometimes get befuddled and be reported as a crime when it's not. So I think you have to warn against that. I mean, unfortunately, in a lot of cases, if someone were to walk up to you in the street and say something ugly that's, you know, racial, anti-Semitic, anti-gay, whatever the case might be, that is also not a hate crime. That's probably an exercise of freedom of speech and more of a hate incident. And so I see a lot of times this kind of confusion over the issue of what should be hate crime and what is more responsibly described as a bias incident or a hate incident.
Mm-hmm. Heidi, you mentioned the KKK. I know, Jesse, you have reported on the KKK in the past, right?
Right. Mm-hmm. When I started with the Associated Press in South Carolina, covering the KKK was one of my beats. And we always, once again, as journalists, we always have to be careful about the words we use in describing the incidents that we're covering. And so I learned early on to be specific and precise, especially when dealing with organizations like the KKK, because since we're a journalistic organization, we need to be sure that our reporting is fair to everyone, to be able that we only report exactly what we see and what we know. And even when dealing with organizations that are considered hate groups, our standards stay the same. We report what we know. We report what we see. We do not include our opinions or our biases in our journalism. And it's something I learned early on.
Mm-hmm. Heidi, can you tell us a little bit about what resources exist on the on your website that would be useful to journalists as they are reporting on the upsurge in hate crimes in their neighborhoods?
Sure. So we have put out a couple of reports about the post-election period on the website, about post-election hate incidents, and also two that get mentioned less that were about, we call these reports the Trump effect, about the climate in schools, K-12 schools across the nation, and what teachers have reported that they've been seeing, which has been an increasingly hostile school climate engendered by the divisiveness of the election. We also have an entire section on, it's called For the Record. It's basically hate incidents that are happening around the country that might be useful. And we have a lot of information on what is and isn't a hate crime. I'd like to put in a plug for my colleagues at the Anti-Defamation League, who have some really good information on state-level hate laws and so on. That doesn't obviate the need to talk with, you know, representatives where you are, you know, the appropriate agencies. But they have a really good section on how hate crimes are different in different places, what they include, what they don't include, why, the history of hate crimes. So I'd suggest that as well.
And Jesse, what other resources do you suggest for reporters?
Well, the first place I would send reporters is to your AP style book, because in the style book, you'll see definitions of of how and when we should use some racial identifiers. You'll find information about how we describe crimes. There are also other resources out there that I highly suggest reporters go to as well. The FBI keeps a list of hate crime statistics on their website. I would send people there because we always need context in the, in our stories of how often things happen. And there are organizations like Pointer, the Society of Professional Journalists, who have guidelines on their websites on how journalists should write about racial profiling, racial identifiers, when to identify, when you can and cannot identify the victims of a crime, when you can and cannot identify the perpetrators of a crime. There are plenty of resources available to journalists who want to know more and to better inform their reporting on these type of incidents around the country. But once again, I want to emphasize that these are conversations that need to be had inside of individual newsrooms and individual organizations. The absolute worst time to make a decision about whether a victim can or cannot be named is in the heat of the moment. These are all conversations that need to be had ahead of time, so your organization will have one voice when speaking with these speaking about these incidents, not having to make a decision 2 minutes before deadline and your paper goes to bed. So I highly suggest that organizations have these discussions beforehand, before an incident happens and their reporters have to write about it. But there are plenty of places to go to on from journalistic organizations like the National Association of Black Journalists, Unity. There are plenty of organizations that have guidelines and suggestions on how to deal with race bias crimes and hate crimes. And I suggest reporters take advantage of them.
Well, thank you. Today we've learned best practices for reporting on hate crimes and extremist groups. Our thanks to Jesse Holland, race and ethnicity reporter for the Associated Press, and to Heidi Beirich, intelligence project director at the Southern Poverty Law Center. Resources from this webinar will be posted for your use on MPF's website at nationalpress.org.